Hey everyone, welcome to episode 31 of Music on the Run. Yeah, I dressed up for the intro. Actually, I got a gig right now. Hey, next on Music on the Run is my neighbor, fellow bass player. Yeah, and an incredible three-time Grammy winning producer. Jerry Wonda is next on Music on the Run.
Hey everybody, St. Paul here down in the basement still. Welcome to episode 31 of Music on the Run. My next guest is a three-time Grammy Award-winning producer, writer, a UN Goodwill Ambassador for Haiti, ambassador that is, governor for the New York chapter of the Grammys, on the board at the Newark Symphony Hall, and is a philanthropist, most recently raising money for Music Cares to help musicians while concerts are halted. Along with Wyclef, he produced and was in the Fugees, one of the best-selling hip-hop groups of all time. My neighbor, and a guy who has more basses than anybody I know, please welcome my buddy, Jerry Wonda. Jerry, I'm going to superimpose that groove over the top of that because that was too good, man. We started the show and he had a groove going. He's like, wait, no, it's not recording. So that's all right. We'll figure out in post how to do all that.
Yeah, and plus how we gonna have fun. But I gotta tell you, man, Paul, I'm so happy to meet you. You're such a great spirit, and you're like one of the classiest musician. You're so talented. When I see you playing upright bass, when I was a kid, I couldn't afford no upright bass. I had not even bass lessons. I always wanted to learn upright bass. Till today, I have one in the background of me right now. I don't know how to play, but I played on as a producer. We play things that we don't even know.
Exactly right. yes, we do, and we fix it until it's right, don't we?
We played 100 times. I remember I did a song. There's a movie called Hotel Rwanda.
Yeah.
And I had a sound that I want to, for that song, and I said I want to play fretless bass, but I don't know how to play fretless. I went and bought myself a fretless bass, and I just played till I was able, felt that it was on tune. And that was the first time, you know, and I actually played fretless bass, a great one, and it's being a musician, a producer, you know, you play everything, but I was so happy to see you playing the guitar, the way you play guitar, the way you play the bass. You're a genius, man. Thank you for inviting
me. Oh, I don't know, but man, let me tell you something. So just to my listeners who don't know that we are friends, Jerry, you came to Minnesota, I think you and I decided the other day when we were writing a song, this is another story, while I was on the beach in Miami, you're calling me and you're like, when are we going to write a song? And he was in the middle of writing the song, and we wrote the song while I was on the beach. It was hilarious. Anyways, we decided that he moved to Minneapolis 5 years ago. We had met through mutual friends, Ken Valdez and Paul Pesco, yeah. I think, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And exactly. We have been trying to nail down times to hang, and we finally get, you know, we were able to do that, but he's got a beautiful family. And you spend a lot of time in Minnesota, but right now, where are you right now?
Right now, I am in New Jersey. And
okay.
I own a recording studio in Manhattan, Times Square, called Platinum Sounds. And, you know, I grew up in East Orange, Newark, Irvington. That's where I grew up, New Jersey, you know?
Got it. Right. So you do a lot of commuting back and forth. Is that right? Obviously, you're keeping your studio alive, Platinum Recording.
Yes, I do. And believe it or not, Platinum Sound is
been Platinum around. Sound, sorry.
Yeah, 20 years being around. And put it this way, Platinum 20 years, but Booger Basement for about since 1993. We have the studio Booger Basement, and that's the studio where I produced the Score album with my cousin Wyclef and Miss Hill, Lauren Hill, L Boogie, Enterprise, and it's a studio. You know how you have your brother, my brother, and I put together in Wyclef, three cousins, and two brothers and one cousin build that recording studio. And guess what? It's 25 years of that score album. And a few that score, Killing Me Soft, it was done in a basement at my dad's house. And with the Fugees, we produced that whole album.
In that basement?
Yes, sir.
Because you came, now you, we're neighbors, but you... You're a long way from where you grew up. Give me a little snippet of how you came to the U.S. and how that all transpired.
Well, man, I got to take you back. Let's start with
Please do.
And I remember my mom grew up in a country. I'm from Haiti, of course.
Right.
But we grew up more like in a farm part of Haiti, where I was born at. And I remember my mom, I used to get in a donkey with my mom, go buy avocado mangoes to go sell in a flea market to raise us, to sell and buy us food, clothes, even toys, you know, when I was a kid. And I got introduced to a bass guitar in a church. And I started playing, and I felt so special because being a musician, you find people after, on a Sunday, people come to and say, you really touch my soul the way you play.
Right. I know.
Best feeling. I think that is bigger than the money, you know. Mm. And I was doing that. By the time my dad, I moved to the U.S., and my dad sent me directly straight up to his sister's house, which is Wyclef Jean's mom.
Got it.
And that's how Wyclef and I, we end up doing music, and we got everything. And I produced 7 albums for Wyclef, you know. And because of that, but guitar was my thing. But I learned how to play from guitar. But too many, my cousin, everybody want to play the guitar. And I picked the bass because nobody knew what the bass was. That's a bass. Okay, I played it. And I find out the bass, you more sexier playing the bass than even in the guitar. I'm sorry, guitar players, you know.
You're going to get some letters over that, some emails on that one.
Yeah, I get beat up on that. So, you know, that's my background. And music, I know music. I never knew I could make money playing the music. And the first time I got paid $10, I was like, okay, that's good, $10. And my next time I got $150,000 in a project that I did.
Right.
You know, with the Fugees, I was like, stop playing. I need to quit working. I need to focus more. And that was it for me since then. And you know, by doing that, you know, I end up right now over 200 million records sold from the work that I've done.
It'd be crazy.
Carlos Santana, Beyonce, Michael Jackson, and, you know, of course, you know, Justin Bieber, and keep going and going.
Yeah.
Project, you know, so, and from a kid that came from Haiti and, you know, went to school in a donkey.
Wow. Why are you, it seems, you know, I know you. And every time I talk to you, your energy is so incredible, man. And is it because you love music that much?
You know what? I love music. And one thing I learned, I get every day I wake up, I learn what am I happy? Anything that I could, you know, I could acknowledge that something great, and I would come up with one. And that make me feel happy. And I always said, I never care about, you know, Jerry Wonda. Oh, Jerry Wonda. People call me a legend alive. And I'm like, okay, legend. I don't know where's the legend. But I am, you know, because of my work, legend, you know.
Yep.
You're talking about Jerry, like things I am. This is Carlos Santana, Maria Maria. You know what I'm saying to you? This is record that, you know, from that bass, you know what I'm saying, playing, you know what I mean? You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, that sample, like, you know what I mean? Like, how good it, you know? And you're talking about, I take a version of like this, make Killing Me Softly for Lauryn Hill, you know?
Jerry, it's hard to hear your voice because I want to hear you talk over that, because you're just playing a string of hits that everybody's going to go, he did that? He did that? I got to be able to hear you talk over that, though, man, because we couldn't hear your voice. I heard that sample good and loud, though.
I know that sample is loud, but
no, it's beautiful, man.
Let me just.
There we go. Now I got your voice.
I'm playing. So one of the songs that, you know, that one of my classic is this one right here. If you can hear it, that's Carlos Santana, Maria Maria. Once again, it's the bassline sample and these drums. You know, like you know what I'm saying. Classic. You know what I'm saying? That's one of Jerry Wonda classic. You know. You might know this song.
Never heard the song before in my life.
You know, and that one. And one of the other songs I remember from the Booger Basement.
Yeah.
And while we was doing the score, which is gonna be 25 years, and February 13th, one of the songs that really got the food just really got to the level, and it's one of them that called. We took a version of this record, "Killing Me Softly," Roberta Flack, and we went and did a new version with Lauryn Hill. You know, L Boogie, big shout out to Miss Hill on that record. And instead of rap, we like, we got to do one song. You singing, and we picked this song, this song right here. Hold up. And this is the Roberta Flack version. Right. But I always love it, you know? That record is a classic! Then that's one of them. Then I'm going to play you another classic. I remember I got a call from Sony. They had an artist, a Spanish artist that was so big. Yeah. Came to my studio, like, you got to do a song for this girl. And they came to see me and Wyclef. And we was like, okay, who's the artist? They're like, Shakira. I was like, who's Shakira? Yeah. So we want to know who Shakira is. And they showed me, we was like, okay, we got to do a song. And I end up sample this. I use this record right here.
Yeah.
So people knows that record. That's Hips Don't Lie. Then I end up doing. So when I tell you it was one of the classic people really love, so I've done classic records, you know.
You have, man. It's, what defines a classic? What's the DNA of a classic song, Jerry?
The one that you do, you don't know it was gonna last so long, but you know it feels good. It was a great record. And I was talking last night with Lauryn Hill, which is called Miss Hill. She said to me, Jerry, I already know that was going to be a hit. I got to tell you, I don't know when it's going to be a hit, but I just know people going to like listening to it for the records that I do. And a classic is like, you know, like, for example, you do a classic, like the same way I go sample somebody's music, like those songs I play you, but people like DJ Khaled go ahead and sample my song and, you know, we do my song over. You know what I'm saying? Can you hear me? You still can't hear me?
Yeah, I got you. Yeah, and I got you good.
You know, when I have a song like this, like, you know, like this record right here, which is Carlos Santana. Now, DJ Khaled love it so much and go ahead and do something like this, right? The same song. Same song, right? Check it out. Then DJ Khaled take it. Another one. Rihanna's on it.
Right.
I don't know if you could tag it.
Those are classic that I created.
Yeah.
Sample me. And the thing is like, a song like this, and you know, when I did Maria Maria, it was on A. It was on A minor. Then he sampled it and put it on C major, which is almost the same thing, but it's different sonic.
Yeah, sure is. Man, they're sampling you now, man.
Yeah, I know.
So take me back to those days, because when you had the success with the Fugees, you were a young man.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
How did you, was that tough for you to handle?
I got to tell you, I didn't know what it was because I was so focused at the time. I just know it was felt good when I love the studio. I'm not a live player, but I love studio. Mm. I would go on tour, I always have a recording studio, or wherever I go, I rent a recording studio. So right, I was right. always go to the show, and I was a music director. So I would go make sure the sound check is done, the mini sound check is ready to go. I go to the studio, bring my clothes, start recording. Then when it's time for the show, I go straight from the studio into the show, and after the show, everybody goes to the after party. I go back to the studio. You know what I'm saying? I go back to the studio. So it was always, I was always busy, but it went fast. I realized that I only spent maybe 2 weeks. 1997, I spent only maybe two weeks at home in my own bed.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was on the road.
So 25 years later, is it exciting to be in the studio as it was back in those early days?
Oh my God, it's the best feeling being in the studio. I don't think I could never quit a studio live. I love it, but I'm probably gonna, like at my house, I have two recording studio. Then I have a recording studio in New York, and I even create a recording studio in Minnesota. So everywhere I go, any diner, and can I tell you one thing?
Yeah.
1997, going to 98, I recorded in a place close to, in two blocks from where I live now in Minnesota.
Were you at Flight Time?
Yes. I did No Women No Cry remix with the Marleys because I was on tour with Smoking Groove, they called Smoking Groove Tour, with the Marleys, Buster Rhymes, all of Black Eyed Peas. We was on tour, and the craziest thing was, we not Black Eyed Peas. It wasn't Black Eyed Peas wasn't there around. But we decided to find a studio, and we went to record at that studio.
Yeah.
And the tour bus was right in the back. And I went to the gym there, and I looked at the place. I said, "Hold up, why this place was so familiar?" And I found out that's where the recording studio was, and it was they had just sold it.
Oh yeah, you know that building is obviously so historic because of Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis. But after they sold it, it became a music college that I ended up running for about 7 years. And isn't that crazy? I mean, it's such a small world.
I would have bought it. We would have bought that building. And I tell you, there's a lot of things we could have done with that building. I'm telling you, with the school program, but in a global way, because I have the platform where we could have done it in a global way. And it wasn't just, I mean, I got mad because it was such
a
situation. I got mad and you know.
I remember you calling me and said, "Paul, what's up with this building? I hear it's been sold. They're going to tear it down." I'm like, "I think you're about a month too late." Yeah, because I remember you called me about that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, you know, that's my story and you know, with music. Right now, I'm working on a lot of things, project for mental health, and I'm working on in bipolar. I'm working on right now, besides doing a help in New Jersey. And I want to tell you, I definitely want to help in Minnesota because I'm there too. Any program that I could come and mentor and help out, and I love to be a part of it, you know? So definitely one of the things.
Jerry, besides music, you have other passions in your life. And it seems like from the research that I've done, your primary goal is to give back to the underprivileged, not only in Haiti and in South Africa, but even here in America. Why is that so important to you?
It's so important to me because when you're looking at, you see a Wyclef Jean, you see a Jerry Wonda, we actually grew up in a church, a burned down funeral home that my uncle, which is Wyclef's dad, went and bought. And I remember over 16 of us living there. And I know what it means and what I did missing if I had a certain help. And I feel like as a Jerry Wonda, I could be in a community. So I partner with communities where I work out and home for musician, and also not just give him the home, really creating recording studios in that home. Feel like I could find the next Whitney, we could find the next Prince, you know, in Minnesota, but that we helping already. We create that platform. So housing, that things that we're doing, and get kids out of trouble. You know, I think music, art really could get kids out of trouble, because if they love it, they don't want to do nothing else. They don't even want to go outside, you know? And yeah. That's why we're so good. We practice so much to be good, to be great. So we barely have enough time to even go outside, you know, to do bad things or to even do other things. So I'm creating program to affordable housing, and that's a, you know, entrepreneur. Those are the things that are, for me, give back is the key. I'm always going to do that. I go to Haiti. I go to Africa. I even go to India, you know. I go to India a lot, you know, and I'm after to help communities. And you know, in Minnesota, I'm very quiet. When I'm in Minnesota, I'm a dad. You know, I'm a driver. I drive my family, and I do the garbage, do the dishes.
I know that one.
Yeah. But the minute I land in Newark, New Jersey, I'm like the Matrix, and they pick me up with a coat lab. You know, I have my lab coat on me and get in a car. And I'm moving so heavy between studio session, between everything I'm doing on the planet. So, you know, for me, I can't stop, man. And every day is a new day for me, and humble, you know?
Jerry, how many things do you have going on at the same time right now, musically and with your philanthropy?
Okay.
You've got like 80,000 things, right?
Well, you know what? I have a Newark I'm helping out, and it's not hard work with Newark, a symphony hall that I'm helping. That venue been around since for 95 years, and I even perform in that venue. I was talking to Lauren Hill. That's it. Jerry, I was 7 when I performed in that venue.
Wow.
And I see that venue, we want to help that venue survive. Then I'm on a project in Newark to affordable housing, helping people. So all I do is I bring a band together. You know what's a great band together? You don't have to be doing solo by yourself. You don't have to be the performance, play the instrument. Every musician could be a part. And I create bands and my businesses I get involved with. So I don't have to work too hard. But every details, like, you know, the thing I'm able to do, it's just easy for me. So I add that. So I'm able to do that. Then I own a recording studio called Platinum Sound. We run in Tribeca. That's where all the artists are recording. I'm working on that. Beside that, you know, that's the thing to change the world for me. I'm doing plus other businesses. It's not a lot, because I have a great infrastructure. I put people in place to just focus and let them do what I do. And I could be on the phone with you right now for an hour. I'm not worried about anything else.
Oh, it's true. But one of the things I want to focus on, because, you know, we don't get downtime, but the being on the road, there's not any touring going on. And you've done something really cool, is you've partnered with Music Cares, which is a division of NARIS, which is the Grammy Awards. Tell me a little bit about Share Music You Love.
Share Music You Love was, of course, sitting on a board. I was looking for something to do because I wanted to be close to my family. So I spent 5 months in Edina. And while I was there, I was looking, I set up a bunch of equipment. I bought a bunch of cameras and set up, and I said, I want to do something. And one day I had a board meeting with the Grammys, and I was like, oh, this is what I want to do. They're like, oh my God, Jerry, you want to do that? Then I called all my friends from Akon, Wyclef, and so many artists, there's so many people. And I asked them something I want to do. Can I raise money? And they said, Music Cares. And I said, but one thing I didn't want to do, I didn't want to be the one people give me a check. I didn't want to collect. And I created this show called Share Music You Love, where people log into on Zoom, where I get people to talk about music they love, things that they love. Next thing you know, I was a part of it. I helped over 30,000 people, musicians that need a check. Before they even get government checks, we was happy musician. That's not touring musician. That's not playing in a club. So
right.
About that and Music Care. And I have a friend in Minnesota that said, Jerry, thank you. I did receive a check for $1,200. And it's somebody I know in Minnesota for Music Care. So I has really did share money with people. So it's a great thing.
What a very incredible thing to be a part of, because it has been, music was the first to go touring along with the event industry. And I mean, there are other industries, but I'm speaking specifically about the music industry. First to go and could be one of the last to come back, at least in the larger capacity. So for you to do that is really cool. And the other things I see you involved with, I mean, you and I could sit and talk music all day, but I'm kind of diving in to that guy, that soul that I know you have,
yes,
which I think is equally important, if not more so. And that is, when you're on the board at Newark Symphony Hall, and am I correct in saying that you're working with the diversity and inclusion initiatives for them?
Yes, 100%. Because when you're talking about Newark, that venue, you have the Rolling Stone perform there. It's a mix of, you know, Celia Cruz perform there, Aretha Franklin perform there, you know. And for me, how do we diversity? How do we keep everybody be a part of that venue for the next 5 years? Because it's going to be 100 years.
And my You're right.
Everybody, Dionne Warwick, all these people, you know, that's alive right now, that's performed there. How do I get them together? And also raise money, because I want to create music programs. I was talking to the mayor, Roz Baraka, and the whole team, you know, Tanisha and Fahimi, that's really working hard. Two women that's in power there. They're doing so they're working so hard to make it happen. And then the process too is about $40 million that's the goal thereafter to really revamp the venue, get that, you know. So I'm glad to be a part of it. That's how I wake up every day, happy.
Since we're on the subject of Newark, talk to me about your relationship with the mayor of Newark and the new video that you put out not that long ago. What was that all about?
Well, I tell you like this. You see this shirt I'm wearing, that's the Fugees, the score. Yep. If you have the score, when we did that score album, in between song, you know how we put a skit, the little interlude. So,
oh yeah, uh-huh.
All the interlude that was on the Fugees, Roz Baraka, the mayor, never thought he was going to be the mayor. He was doing poetry and comedy and stuff. And he was the one that did it. He was one of them that did that. So I know Roz for a long
wow.
time. And now he turned to be the mayor. Now he's on his second term. He's a great man. Then we end up talking. And one day I say, yo, you still writing? Come see me at the studio. You know how we do.
Of course.
He came to see me at the studio, and I pick up the bass, and I start a groove, and I said, go ahead, give me one of your poem, you know what I mean? And he did it. It sounds so good. I was like, we doing a project. Then we end up doing five
Of course
songs.
You did.
You know? We end up doing five songs together, and, you know, with my musician, put the team together. You know, I'm very good at that, put the team together and come up with the right thing, because I always know what I want. I used to pick up a guitar, play some chords, and say, this is what we're going to do, pick up a bass, and usually I play things, and the musician come, no, replace me. They're like, what do you mean, no? I say, we play what I play, because I play just to play it. They have it, but I don't like my playing, you know? So being a producer, I do that a lot. So I did that with Roz. Then, next thing you know, this whole thing happened
yeah.
with Corona and with what's going on when I was in, I was in Minnesota right there where Floyd, you know, got killed, you know, and I was like, oh my God, that song really with the movement that was going
yeah.
on. That song meant so much. Then we did a video, my part, you know, we did a video. We put that video out. Next thing you know, it just pick up. And that's my relationship with the mayor. And that's Newark. So very connected.
That's a complete positive relationship. And you go way back with him. Now, you and I, like I said, we're neighbors. We live, 10 minutes away from where George yeah. Floyd was murdered.
Wow.
How do we, you and I, find a way through that, through our music,
yes.
to be able to bring people together? Maybe the real question is how can we be better advocates for anti-racism all over the world? What do you think our job is there?
I think our job is really to have a talk to, always to see what do the city doing? How do we go ahead and sit down with the mayor and say, well, we're doing, this is what we're doing, between the Grammys, between affordable housing, between the things that we're doing. How do we make music? Music, there's no politics on music. How do we use our platform to get people to be a part? We talk to the young people, because a lot of the trouble that's going to young people. How do we mix it? One thing I tell you, I'm in Minnesota, how I see people really connected, colors. The people that want to, we all, it's so much culture. You have Indian culture, you got African culture, you got white culture, you have all kind of culture, you know, the island culture in Minnesota is diversity. How do we go ahead and I remember you called me, and I was very excited when you called me. I want to tell you, when you say, Jerry, I want you to be a part of the YMCA. I was in my head, I said, okay, YMCA, okay. You have YMCA, you also you have the older people YMCA, and you have the young people YMCA. How do we go in to see how we said, okay, film, let's raise money to get film equipment. So mm-hmm. they could have studios, so they could learn how to film. Maybe give them a camera, go shoot something, let's do the edit, let's do something. Because remember, your voice and my voice could go further than the young people right now. Your voice and my voice, because you came from Prince, you came from you're who you are. Then I came from where I'm coming. I know if we go, let's sit down with the mayor. Let's say, what are you doing for your city? You have Jerry Wonda, you have Paul Peterson, that really in their world, that been around music. How could we help you? Okay, we there to help, because anything you're doing, how we connected, and we come up with ideas through music and art. And I think it's something great we could be doing, because I know they have to be careful for the young people, because the young people gonna, you know, and the way the young people, they love music. You know, some of them trouble, you know, the troublemakers, we could definitely work with them. You know, you feel me? So when you told me about YMCA, I really couldn't wake up, and I wake up like I'm so happy, and I love to be a part. And let's think about it, because this whole thing about Newark, I woke up one day and said I wanted to do it. The minute I said that, doors was open.
Yeah, right. Isn't it wonderful how music and art can, for me, I mean, it may be a different experience for other people. I'll speak for me. Never in my career of playing mostly black music have I ever been an outcast, chastised. I've always been everyone. White, black, purple, green, whatever, have always done this to me. And I'm holding my arms out like a hug here for those of you who are just listening on audio. Music has an opportunity, and arts have an opportunity to bring people together like nobody else. I feel like we are somewhat insulated, and I said this with my interview with Kenny Aronoff on the last episode, and we have a unique opportunity to be able to help bring people together of every background, of all colors, of all religions, of all sexuality, because it's about the music. It has nothing to do with what your belief is. It's about coming together.
Yes.
And I think you and I have a unique opportunity. We're from completely different planets, you know? Yes. But yes. We don't care. The minute I met you, I was like, that's going to be one of my really good friends. And that's just the way it is.
Yes.
So I welcome the fact that you want to help out locally too, not only globally with your being a UN ambassador to Haiti, but you do it on a micro level too, and I think that's super admirable. And to use your platform for good, man, because there's people out there who would use the platform that you've been given to separate.
Yes.
And you choose not to do that. Yeah, you choose to bring people together. I think that's a beautiful thing, man.
And growing up in church, I remember when I was talking to you, like, Jerry, you know, I go to church. I said, excuse me, you go where? You go to church? You're like, I go to church, and I go whenever Sunday I'm around, I go to church and play, pick up that instrument. That remind me of me, because I still go to that same church I helped build, which is where I used to live at, you know, a Haitian church. And that's how, in our culture, every Sunday, the Haitians, it definitely goes to church, because that's the only way they get to see each other. Because everybody got two jobs and one job. And the thing, and Sunday is like the way we all, I'm eating Greek. And that's when we like, oh, uncle, how you are, you uncle? And, you know, sure. You know, your cousin and everybody. So When you say that to me, man, I was touched. I was touched by it. And I feel like there's so much we could do to really help musicians. We have access to so much information that we could and work with them. And you know, that's my life. That's the rest of my life. That's what I want to do. Do what I like to do. Things that could make a difference.
Right. Okay. So because this podcast is called Music on the Run, we focus on tips to be able to maintain the level of how busy you are and still be able to be healthy, keep your relationships together. Is this something that you are able to do when you get up in the morning? You're just raring to go. Do you have any kind of a routine that helps clear your mind? Is it a workout? Or tell me what that looks like to you.
Well, for me, when I wake up, I never leave my house. It's something since I was a kid I always do. I never leave my house without praying. And I always believe in a higher power to pray and to make sure to filter me from anybody with bad energy. It's very important for me. I do my workout. Definitely, I love my work. If I have to do at least 100 push-ups a day, and if I get them, I have a Peloton bike or Peloton thing. Treadmill that I have, I use, and that's it. And I think anything I could be grateful for.
Yeah, you know?
And that's very important. And beside that, man, I just go on the run because I always go from one, two, three. And the minute I don't like something, I move away. And that's it, man. Stay happy and always remember, nobody could get you have your bad day. Only you can let somebody in to have you have a bad day, because you wake up with a good day. Anything happen, whatever you don't get wasn't yours. That's rule number one. You know what I mean? So
your attitude is a choice when you wake up. You shed the bad vibes by praying. You do your workout. You make a choice to have a good day. And then if it's, something doesn't feel right, you just move away and start the next one.
That's it.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what. I already know what you're currently working on. I mean, I don't know what you're doing out there, but I know that you and I wrote a song and we talked about it. In the beginning of this, when I'm sitting on a beach in Miami Beach, I'm just finishing up a record for those of you who are listening and don't know that it should be out later this year. But Jerry said, I got something, man. I got something. So we started writing it and I'm hollering at him on the beach while I'm sitting out in the sun. So I know you're going to help me with that. But tell me some of the other things that you've got on your plate right now that we can look forward to.
Okay, right now, for the past 48 hours, I was able to get my band, the Fugees, back in communications.
This is big news.
Yes.
This is big news.
Because El Boogie, you know, everyone know, goes by Michelle, goes by Lauren Hill, called me and said, Jerry, let's put some content together. I have so much content. And believe it or not, I just realized, but after I start going through my song, I have over a whole new album on the Fugees. I don't even have to record nothing.
What?
I realize how much content that I have with content, you know, and with the album that nobody knew we had, because I think I still got more that if I start going to 2-inch reels, I realize that song outtakes that we didn't use, and I find out that we have a video that we did with like 30,000 people, and I recorded on Pro Tools, and also different camera angles we never touch. And that's a whole live concert nobody ever seen or
heard. That's incredible. People are going to freak out when they hear this. Have you released that information yet? Does anybody know this yet?
No, not yet.
Well, you heard it first here on Music on the Run. I feel privileged that we know that. Well, I'll tell you what, being a fan, I can't wait to hear what you've got on disc and going to put out. You thinking about possibly recording some new stuff?
Yes, we're thinking about doing some new stuff too.
Okay.
But right now, they only talking about we shoot the album, the classic album with a different outtakes, and maybe 2-3 songs. That's it. Because it's all about the release of that album.
Oh, yeah.
Which I'm so excited. You know, team is very happy. Yeah. You know? So that's it, man. That's one of the things I'm working in. I do have a label called Wonder Music that I have an artist named Coco that just got my God, Hot 97, which was one of the top radio stations, just add her to rotation, and everybody talking about her. She's really good, but she's hip hop. You know what right. I mean? She's a hip hop and you know, I have a couple artists I'm doing development on, a label, major labels are looking. But before I take any artist to a major label, I'm always working it out first, build them in a way first before the major label, because you could go to a major too early, it's not good.
Right.
You get stuck, and I work with my artists. I always tell the artists, I'm not here to give you $1 million. I'm not here to give you even $10,000, but I'm going to show you how you make your first $1 million.
There you go. Jerry Wonda, the educator.
Yeah, 100%, because it's not the front money that you get in you and that longevity. So let me help you, and let me go ahead and do songs with you. Let me, we put it out where we partner on it, and also... I pay for videos and pay for a little marketing, but get you to a level where I could get a call from Clive Davis. That's all.
Right, right.
Like, Jerry, that I didn't know you was a part of it. So
well, that's your reputation, though, man. So if anybody has the opportunity to ever work with you, my friend, is very lucky and blessed. Thank you for taking an hour with us, man. Yeah, I look forward to you coming back to Minnesota. You and I have some work to do,
yes.
And not only musically, but we got work to do in this community together. Yeah. And I look so forward to partnering with you, not only at the Southdale YMCA, but beyond and beyond, to heal some hearts and bring people together.
Yes, I'm 100%. Let's just do it.
And I love it.
By doing a couple of Zooms, start talking to people. I'm ready. Let's go.
Let's do it. Ladies and gentlemen, Jerry Wonda, thank you all for joining us. Episode 31 of Music on the Run is in the books. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Music on the Run was hosted by yours truly, St. Paul Peterson. Edited and produced by my buddy, Davide Raso. Video editing by Ivan Sebastianov. And a very special thanks to the people who financially support this podcast. And remember, music can connect us. Yeah.